diabetic retinopathy. We'll discuss how it is diagnosed, what are the clinical features, what are the treatment options do we have, what are the treatment options, how we apply them, what are the complications, how we can prevent it. So proliferative diabetic retinopathy, we know that it's a preventable disease. You can treat it in an early stages so that it doesn't reach to a blinding stage. It's a major cause of blindness in adults and elderly people, but we can prevent it. We can reduce the number of blindings by treating diabetic retinopathy at an early stage or when it comes to a proliferative stage. We know that diabetic retinopathy, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, is characterized by the formation of new vessels. They start forming new vessels on the retina, mostly on the disc, or they are formed elsewhere. Sometimes you see them on the iris. When there is someone in trouble, it cries for help. And this is new vessel formation is a cry for help of the retina. The retina becomes hypoxic, ischemic, and then it cries for help. It started producing vasoformative angiogenic factors. They lead to formation of these as I just mentioned, it's a microangiopathy which affects the retinal precapillary arterioles, capillaries, and venules. If the microvascular leakage is predominant, we have mild and moderate NPDR. But if we have more severe microvascular occlusion leading to ischemia, then we see this severe non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy and proliferative diabetic retinopathy. This is just a diagrammatic presentation. That how this, you see this ischemic area here. You have a microvascular occlusion. It leads to retinal ischemia. And this retinal ischemia then leads to the formation of AV shunts or IRMA formation. It can lead to neovascularization and ultimately will lead to fibroglial proliferation, which is a more severe form of the disease. Now, fibrovascular proliferation, when the vessels and the fibrous tissue along with them, when they start growing, it has three stages. First of all, they will have fine new vessels that grow with minimal fibrous tissue on the surface of the retina, and then they penetrate and extend beyond the internal limiting membrane. They cross that barrier, and then they start growing under the vitreous surface, using it as a scaffold. Then these new vessels, with the passage of time, they grow in size, they grow in the extent, and they become more extensive. The fibrous component also increases. In the later stages, sometimes these new vessels regress, leaving only residual fibrovascular tissue, which is very strongly adherent to posterior hyaloid, and it ultimately, because of the traction of the retina vitreous, it can cause tractional retinal detachment. This is a classification we are all well versed with, this classification of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. We'll just focus on this severe NPDR and very severe NPDR. In severe NPDR, or non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, we have hemorrhages in four quadrants, or marked venous beating in two or more quadrants, or IRMA in one or more quadrants. Any of these, if you see, then you can label it as severe NPDR. This is a stage where the diabetic retinopathy can progress further, if not treated, to a further severe form of proliferative type. Again, very severe non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. If you see all these features or any of the two or more in any of the quadrant, then it can cause a very severe form. Now, this is a subdivision of how proliferative diabetic retinopathy is classified. There are new vessels on the disc or new vessels elsewhere. but insufficient to meet the high risk criteria, which we will discuss later. This is known as mild to moderate. In high risk, what is high risk? When you see any neovessels on the disc with vitreous or pre-retinal hemorrhage of any degree, you label it as a high risk. It's going to lead to further complications. Then neovessels on the disc, which are about one-third of the disc diameter, I'll tell you diagrammatically in the next slide, and neovessels elsewhere, if they are more than half diameter, sometimes they are associated with pre-retinal hemorrhage or vitreous hemorrhage, they are high risk, and they can lead to advanced diabetic proliferative stage. If this stage left untreated, it can progress to advanced diabetic eye disease. When the treatment of diabetic retinopathy, PDR, is either insufficient, inadequate, or is not done, it can lead to pre-retinal hemorrhages, tractional retinal detachments, rubiosis, and ultimately leading to glaucoma. This is just a picture of neovascularization on the disc, which is equal to or greater than one-fourth or one-third of the diameter. If you see these neovessels on the disc with some hemorrhage, it is a high-risk case. Or neovessels, any amount with vitreous or pre-retinal hemorrhage, or NVE, which is equal to or greater than half diameter. So I just mentioned that. This is a diagrammatic. You can see this one-fourth or one-third area involving. If it is less than that, but you have pre-retinal hemorrhage or board-shaped hemorrhage, it is a high-risk case. And if you have neovessels elsewhere, but with a pre-retinal hemorrhage or mild vitreous hemorrhage, it needs treatment. Some fundus photographs of the same. You have neovascularization on the disc with some pre-retinal hemorrhage or vitreous hemorrhage, and these are the neovessels elsewhere, which are more than one half of the disc diameter. Now, your literature says that if you see high-risk patients, then you treat those patients. But I would suggest that if we see neovascularization anywhere in our population, in our society, we must treat that, because you don't know whether the patient is coming back, whether he can have a follow-up, or maybe next time when he comes back, he comes with a vitreous hemorrhage, then you can't treat it. So if you see any sign of proliferation, it's better to treat the retinopathy with laser or with injections. We'll discuss that later. As Dr. Amiravan shown that sometimes the fundus photographs and the fundus picture is deceptive unless you see a fundus fluorescein angiography. So this is a case of severe retinal ischemia. You only see these hemorrhages here, but when you do a fundus photograph, all this area involving the macula is a complete capillary dropout. There's no perfusion in this area. And similarly, this area, which only shows hemorrhage, very well perfused retina otherwise, but you can see at the capillary level, there's complete dropout. So this patient has got with complete dark, non-perfused macula, very less chance of any visual improvement. What you can do is to save the peripheral vision or the peripheral retina that you can save. But the real prognosis is should be explained to patient. Again, neovascularization elsewhere. You see some vessels here which are evident on angiography and they leak on the later frames. This helps to differentiate it from the IRMA or other microvascular abnormalities, that whether they are true neovessels or whether they are just the shunts or collaterals. Now, sometimes we see a patient of severe diabetic retinopathy, non-proliferative, or very severe non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. But these retinopathies can extend to proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and there are certain risk factors for that. Who are the people who can get this conversion very rapidly? There are systemic factors. And these include, obviously, we know that hemoglobin A1C, that means if the diabetes is uncontrolled, the patient is non-controlled, and whatever you do with the eye, it's going to progress. it's not going to stop. Low hemoglobin levels will add further to the retinal ischemia. Lipid levels will lead to further capillary changes and vascular changes. Pregnancy, very important factor. Those patients who are diabetic, who have some changes in their eye, and they must be watched very carefully before they have pregnancy or when during the course of their pregnancy. And duration of the diabetes, of course, we know that more the duration, more the severity, with the exception of few cases. Hypertension adds to this, carotid artery disease, and renal disease. So all these conditions, systemic conditions, they are a risk factor for conversion of non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy into a proliferative type. Ocular risk factors, cataract surgery is the main risk factor. Whenever you perform cataract surgery, either the proliferative diabetic retinopathy further enhances, further progresses, or non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy gets converted into a proliferative diabetic retinopathy. There are chances of increased diabetic macular edema. And the patients who have clinically significant macular edema, severe NPDR or PDR, should undergo photocoagulation if the media is sufficiently clear. Or you can do photocoagulation just after the cataract surgery. If there is high risk, you can give an anti-VEGF injection before doing the cataract surgery. There are certain other factors which can alter the course of PDR. If there is a complete PVD, there is complete vitreous detachment, vitreous is separated from the retina, there are chances that it prevents the development of proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and the scaffold where the new vessels grow is not available. Choroidal degenerations and extensive chorioretinal scarring of the retina acts as a deterrent for proliferation, because this is a large non-functioning retina and the metabolic demands of the retina is less. So there is disparity between supply and demand is less. So the chances of getting ischemic response is less. Now, how can we treat this proliferative diabetic retinopathy? We have few options. Photocoagulation or PRP is the gold standard. Anti-VEGFs, injections intravitreal, they are can be used alone or they can be used as an adjunct treatment with the photocoagulation and steroids. Steroids do not affect directly the proliferation, but they help to reduce the macular edema, which is associated with the treatment of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Like when we do laser, we always get some sort of edema. If it increases, you can use steroids in addition to anti-VEGFs. We know that anti-VEGFs, VEGF is a certain, they are produced from the retina, from the ischemic retina, and they have angiogenic function, and they also aid capillary, they enhance the inflammation. So when we inhibit them, when we block these VEGFs by anti-VEGFs, we stop the progression of neovascularization, and also we reduce the inflammation and preventing diabetic macular edema. Currently, available anti-VEGF agents are, we know that, bevacizumab, ranibizumab, and aflibercept. They're all freely available, but their price differences